Welcome to the Berlinale and to the Teddies, of course. Your film was premiering, I think, 2 days ago, right?
Yes.
And I can imagine that you've been asked a lot about the opening scene. I think it's very beautiful. And the only question I really had was how, and this goes to the two directors, how did you work on really keeping up the special energy? Because I can imagine it's quite difficult to depict what you did, and I was quite impressed how it worked out, you know. But I felt it has a lot to do with energy in the room, you know, and it's tricky to show that.
I can try if you like.
We had a lot of theoretical ideas before doing it. We expect things from the set, from the actors, from the main actors, of course, but also from the other actors all around. And I think the energy, in fact, came maybe a little bit from the place, because it's a real sex club. And I think the energy of the scene is a combination between their energy, the energy of Geoffrey and François, but also the energy of all the complementary characters around, who were like totally invested in the shooting, and who really like enjoyed the set like they can enjoy the club. Mm-hmm. So that probably that's one of the secret of the scene is in that casting. Mm-hmm.
And technically speaking, were you really shooting like in a conventional shoot where you say, you know, action and stop and action? How, I mean, that can be really distracting, you know, if you about sex and stuff. Yes. Like it's,
there were no action, of course. Yeah. I don't like to say action. In fact, okay. I prefer like to that everybody feels that it's the right moment to begin. So I'm not used to say action anyway, okay. But especially on that set, I never say action. Okay. I just ask for the rolling, and everybody knew that when it rolls, it was recording, and when people are ready to act, they act.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Do you want to add something? Maybe how did you experience it, and how was the first time? Did you sort of like have this moment where you said, "We're just gonna let go of all the thoughts and just I am in the moment and perform," or what was it like?
It was like, as we say, we were like always kind of focusing on what was happening and what we had to do, and so we are really like together and like sharing this moment together, François and I, most of the time, and in this action and like doing it the best as we can. And
yes, we were really together, really connected, but really also aware of the energy around by, you know, with the other guys in the room. Mm-hmm. And as Olivier says, no action, go. Mm-hmm. It's like, okay, it's rolling anytime you want. And okay, when we feel it, and you know, day after day, everything, you know, takes the right way to go.
And became easier.
Yeah, and became easier and easier.
Mm-hmm. So as someone who's not French, and I'm not French, you have a very stereotypical image of Paris, right? It's like very beautiful, it's like in the picture books, and the facades of the buildings, and I don't know, like the energy of the city. But now it takes place in a Paris at night, and you don't see a lot of this like stereotypical stuff. And I was wondering why you chose the night, what seduces the night in a way?
Why did you?
Yeah. I think anyway, as they go to a sex club, obviously it's by night, usually. And I don't know, there's something very mysterious in the night in Paris, you know. It's the same city, but it's empty, it's so weird. I like it, I mean, into real life. So we thought it was a good idea to shoot a movie by night. I agree, it's a well-known city, and I mean, as a movie set. Mm-hmm. So it was, maybe it was the idea to show it in a totally different way. And but you see, you also see the facade. You can see,
but it's like, it's dark and it's shadowy, and it's like,
yeah,
you know, it doesn't
and
have
we
this
want,
like
we really wanted,
like
we wanted a very dark night. Yeah. That's on purpose. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes it's really dark, or you can't see the face of the actors, mm-hmm. and it's it was on purpose. It's not accidental. It's not because we didn't have enough money to put light. It's something we really, really wanted because it's like this. I mean, you know, a city by night, there are, you know, spots of shadows and weird things happening. And, well, we try to catch it.
Mm-hmm. And also we were like, as we are aware that Paris is a very like romantic city with a lot of postcards that you can film. We didn't want to, and we filmed these postcards in the past in other movies, especially in Jeanne and the Perfect Guy. And so this time we really wanted to film like a normal neighborhood, the kind of neighborhood we lived in, not the center of Paris, not the very touristic neighborhoods, but just a neighborhood like which is not spectacular, but which is very Parisian, mm-hmm. for Parisians.
For Parisians, yeah, because I was thinking, apart from you as protagonists, you also have like other characters around that like sort of make the film. There's an intern doctor, there's a woman on the subway, there's a very pathetic, older, homophobic guy who sits in the emergency ER. And how do these two guys fit into the social structure you create? It's not this typical Paris too, you know, with these like high flamboyant, I don't know, you know, like, yeah.
Jacques va répondre peut-être.
You mean two guys, two characters? Or
no, how do they fit into this like social life, which is happening at night, you know, like this woman who goes to work in the morning, who obviously, you know, has to hustle because she didn't work, I don't know, well enough to get like a nice pension, and then you have a young doctor who's working at night, and it's like all these people sort of like at the periphery a little bit of society, you know?
Yes, and I think I'm always amazed by all those people, you know, who are living by night and that you can see in the streets. And so I really wanted to put them in the movie because they are all around.
Mm-hmm.
They are very modest people. Mm-hmm. And very often they speak to you in a very unexpected way, you know. Mm-hmm. And they say so incredible things, like that woman in the metro said that, I was too much love. How it is in English? I fall too much in love in my life.
Oh, she's falling in love too much in love, right?
So, and also, I agree, it's also a social environment.
Mm-hmm.
I'm wondering why we did this.
It's okay, I just came to mind, I was thinking about it, I was like, this is
no, but I think it's, there's a lot of purposes, I think, and maybe it's also a way to how to say that? What the character are living is something really, really strong between us. But it's also only a very small love story, you know.
Mm-hmm.
All around, there are so many things happening, you know. There's wars, people with economical difficulties.
Mm-hmm.
And they cross their way. And we thought, well, it's important to remember that those characters are in a society which is difficult, complicated, but still they go on with love, and we do.
Why are you attracted to each other? What attracts the characters to each other? Do you know why do they? What do you think? Like, why are they?
Don't be dirty.
You know, it starts so beautifully in the opening scene. You know, where like it. Step by step, you find each other, and through other bodies too.
Yeah.
First, and like, what is it that?
Well, it's strange because it's their relationship. It starts upside down, like, you know.
Mm-hmm.
They talk about intimate things and personal things at the end of the movie,
mm-hmm.
and first they have first a body encounter,
mm-hmm.
you know. And then walking, having time together, they get to know each other,
mm-hmm.
you know, minutes after minutes. And so, what makes them attracted? Something mystical, mystical. In the beginning, you know, they open the eyes.
It's like a big crush, I think,
yeah,
at the beginning.
Like huge crush. And Vas-y.
No, I can add because we spoke about that when we were preparing the scene and when the travel into the sex club from one and the other to get in touch with the other. This travel goes through another relation.
Yeah.
So they met because both of them were in a relation or in a sex moment with another guy.
Yeah.
And that's the fact that the character who plays Geoffrey, that the fact that Theo sees Hugo having sex with a guy, it's the things which is attractive.
Yeah.
And so he's the first one who is like maybe noticing that this guy, maybe I'm attracted by him, but we never know when Hugo is conscious of the fact that he was attractive. And that's why all these preliminaries are very important, and we wanted to take time to film it or to film them. So when they open the eyes, we understand why it's possible that it's a crush, because we had all the previous moments that gives the energy of the club and the energy of the group, and the fact that it's not two guys who met in the street or at friends, or it's two guys who met in a sex pot.
And for Theo as well, all those preliminaries are made in order to get closer to Hugo.
Mm.
So
yes,
for me, it was the first day of shooting. It was all my way to get closer, get in front of him. And at the end, he's in the right place and Hugo is ready as well to meet.
Mm-hmm.
And
as you said, it was the first day of shooting. So at the end, you have to go to bed and wait until tomorrow.
And during those days, was the club closed or was it specifically open and people were invited, but they knew that it was being shot?
No, it was closed. The club is open by night, but we shoot on the day, during the day.
Mm-hmm.
So we not invited people, but we like, it was like actors who were paid to be here.
All were actors.
Yes, it was. They were all the guys around are actors,
mm-hmm.
who are used to this kind of club, who are gay, who are not regulars from this place, but who knows how it works. Or one or two of them don't really used to the place, but curious of the experience.
Mm-hmm.
All of them were like, in a way, a little bit exhibitionist,
mm-hmm.
of course,
mm-hmm.
and watchers, Pepping Tom
mm-hmm.
guys,
mm-hmm.
of course,
mm-hmm.
and so it was really the job of the casting director Simon Frenet to find them, because he put ads on internet and he had a lot of answers, but when he has really to discuss with the guys, because a lot of people who answers that they were interested, when Simon told them the directors will ask you to do that, are you agree to
like explicit sex?
They said, oh no.
What did they want to do? Just
so
stand
we said goodbye.
Okay. Yeah.
And we find these 12 wonderful guys,
yeah.
and I told before, it was very important for the general energy of the scene.
But I remember that during the shooting, there's the day when we shot the exit of the sex club, it was at night and it was open.
Yes.
And so just I remember that it was really fun that we were like the camera, the team, and the actors, so we were 15, something like that. And people goes in the club. It's a place you go like discreetly, so people are like, oh, when they get out, there were 20 people like this. So it was like, it was funny.
Mm-hmm.
Just for 1 hour, because we begin the shooting like I suppose around midnight, and the club closed at 1:30 during the week. And so the last one who were going out, they were like, the manager says, maybe we will see a camera, but it's not filming.
I have yesterday again, I watched it two times, the films, and there's one scene that is very crucial to me when you're in this falafel shop or something with a
mm-hmm.
Syrian owner. And you talk to him and he talks about his like refugee experience and having fled his country. And then he says at some point, but you are free, or for you it's easier. And then if we look at the current, you know, happenings in the world, and especially in Paris, it's obvious that you are also not free in a way, also not in Paris, because it's fragile, you know, our security, our freedom. And how does this entire situation of the specific of Paris, which is, I guess, suffering still trauma, or like it's only the beginning of it, and France, how does it inform like questions around sexuality and artistic freedom and all that stuff? It's just interesting that he was, I mean, you know, like that he was Syrian and looking at the world right now. It's so timely.
You want to try to answer?
It's complex, I know. It's a very complex question. But for me, the key is freedom, you know, and that's really what France and Paris and culture and art is like. It's such a stereotype worldwide. And right now we experience that it's really not like that anymore. And it's terrible, but it's true.
But one important thing is that we shot the film in summer, so
I
we
know,
shot the film
yeah.
before the
it happened,
the,
but yeah,
yeah. Before the attacks, and even when we shot the film, the war in Syria was not in the exactly in the same like as it's right now. I don't really know why we wanted a Syrian guy, but we really wanted a guy who came from a country which is in war, which is but we didn't came for that reason. Was far from his homeland. He knew that his friends and family are like under the bombs, but he's safe in a way in Paris. But as you said, he's safe, but even Paris is not safe anymore. And but the anyway, all this question of freedom is very important also, because we know that when we come back in Paris and when we will show the film, we will have problem with some extreme right movement regarding the sex, for example, or the fact that the character are gay. And so the freedom is always under control nowadays, even in a very supposed to be very democratic country like France. And in fact, we are like in a special status with état d'urgence. I don't know.
State of emergency.
Right, not the city. Yes. Yeah.
The whole country.
The whole country.
All the country. Yeah. do you want to add something or?
No.
Okay. But still, at the same time, it's not. It's an interesting film in terms of the characters, because it really shows, I feel like, compared to other queer or gay films, like a very mature approach to sexuality and identity, and there's not much like emancipation talk or whatever. And I was wondering, how do you guys read these guys' sexuality, or like, did you think about it at all when you prepared, like what their relationship is to their own gayness, and you know, just taking it as for granted, you know?
Yes, exactly. We take it for granted because it is so normal. It's not a matter, and it's not a matter. Of the movie, you know, of their life, of their everyday life, it's like that, and they're quite happy with that, obviously. And so, yes, I read the script as a normal love story between two people, and not a movie about the discovery of sexuality or no. And that is quite. Agréable.
Pleasant.
It's quite pleasant to deal with characters like that. Because it's normal. It's not the
but
point.
But then you have like these, you know, and that's like this really weird or fucked up thing, because then at the same time, like you said, you have to deal with this weird like Catholic church like in France too, where there were like incidents, I think, in the past, and it's so weird, you know.
But you know, it's
where it's what are these times telling? And then you think like you're free, but then you're not.
But in the same time, it's a very small group of people who made a lot of noise. We don't have to like consider
exactly,
that the fact
that
they made a lot of noise, but they are very, very a very small group of people. I mean, we are much more numerous. The gay people, the gay community in France, for example, is much more numerous than these integrist Catholic. So we don't have to be like under their decision or power, or so it's a very political attitude. I mean, to do the film and to now to show the film, but the chance that we have is that we find a producer who is aware of the risk, but who wanted to take the risk with us. The French release company has the same like consciousness before that we do the film of that, and they were agreed to that we do the film like we imagine or like we wanted, mm-hmm. and now they support us to show the film like it is. Mm-hmm. They didn't ask for any cuts or something like that. Mm-hmm. Or they are, even if they, sometimes they are a little bit frightened, mm-hmm. but they try to figure out how to do it well. And we will have in the next weeks to probably to find solution with these groups. If we will have our first French premiere in France in a gay film festival in Lyon, mm-hmm. in 2 weeks, and it's mm-hmm. a very like bourgeois city in mm-hmm. province, so it will be a good test for us. If there's like, you know, integrist outside of the cinema, maybe it's a sign or...
Oh, wow.
Yeah, okay. Probably. Yeah, well, I mean, I don't know, so, Matt. Yeah, like, yeah, Geoffrey's parents can be here, so...
My love. In terms of the structure, I also just want to talk a little bit about this real-time thing and the this like technology and the blending in of the time and iPhone and like this, you know, what role does that play? Is it just because we live in these times that you chose it, or? You also don't have to answer.
Too,
like,
too much party.
Too much. Too much fuster.
But it serves as a, like, I mean, it seems like a little bit banal, but then at the same time, it serves as a important structure for the film, right? It's crucial.
You're right. I mean, we have to deal with everyday life. So the, for example, phones are really much more important. Apps are much more important in our mm-hmm. life. So if we imagine a story today, we use like we use the facilities and means of transportation that character can use by night in Paris, and but we don't mm-hmm. do it like to be it's just because it's like we live every day, and so it's just that, for example, the fact that you have a mobile phone with you is something which is now very important in the way you tell stories. Mm-hmm. I mean, in every film you have or every TV series on, you have to deal with that, the fact that anybody can be contacted or can contact anybody at any moment, mm-hmm. almost. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. sometimes you have some films that imagine a weird situation that the character loses his mobile phone at the beginning of the film, so he's nobody can join him and can be in touch with him, and mm-hmm. but it's like very much more artificial than the fact that you have a mobile phone in your pocket and you can receive text message and you can make a phone call and you know that the other is in the hospital and you can join him, and mm-hmm. so it was more, it was really the realistic aspect of the technology who interest us in the narrative way to tell a story today's mm-hmm. today. The fact that we use the time like an iPhone time on the screen was a way to like reference the Agnès Varda movie Cléo de 5 à 7, but we did it in a totally different way, because I don't know if you remember, but in Cléo she announced the time. She there's title who says Cléo from 5:10 to 5:20, and so you know you will see 10 minutes of Cleo's life.
But it's the verbal announcement.
No, it's written, but it's written at the beginning of the sequence on the in the bottom of the screen. Okay. So we didn't want to do it the same, but we like to have this like time reminder during the film, yeah. So you can feel that the end of the story will be approaching, mm-hmm. and it works like
yeah,
that also
really
in Cleo.
Yeah. From an acting point of view, was that like the most intense experience so far? I mean, I can imagine it must
yes.
be very,
yes.
you know, I mean, I hope it freed you up for like future projects, but it's, you give a, I mean, you really show and give a lot.
Thank you.
I guess you know that, but it's true, you know?
Well, it's
you told
true.
Them there's a lot of time. For
okay. In preparation.
But it's nice that you told them too.
It's really, I mean, I don't know if I could do that, yeah, really. I'm not an actor too, but I just...
Well, it is for both of us our first part. It was really main part, leading part. And it was great because we had all those hard things to do and scene and dialogues, and every day was challenging. And it's for us, it's a great gift to have those parts that are really interesting and to be able to show off.
Mm-hmm. Yes, we're young, we have a young career, so it is a big, important thing that we have done.
Mm-hmm. Did you have to think before, like after the casting, when they offered you the role, was it like, were there like some days of like, I have to reflect on it? And
of course not.
Okay.
No, so
no.
What did you learn? Was it like your biggest lesson? What do you take away from this experience?
Sharing is definitely important. I mean, being sharing with the other actor, being generous and with the director.
Okay.
I think
like sharing.
It was really easy to work, and Jacques and Olivier put us in a really confident place. And like, I don't felt we were. Sometimes it was hard and not easy, but we were not doubting, or uncomfortable. It was really a nice summer actually, and sharing with the other actor as well is. The most important to be together, like you don't have to be, if you want to be on the light and kill the other actor, then it doesn't work. You have to really be together.
Ego out. Yeah,
of course. And you know, when you have a well-written text, it's always easier for actors to work. And so it was really nice because we worked together a lot during the preparation, you know, reading the script together, working the scenes at home together, because we have a very we had a very short time to shoot the film, so we had to be very ready every day, because sometimes we had like pages and pages of text to shoot, and we didn't have the right to be unprepared. And to arrive on the set like, well, we had to be like that, and we wanted to be like
and
that.
As well, maybe we can say, because we both come from theater.
Yes.
So I think there is something
helps.
Like we both learn plays in the entire play before to work and things like that. So for us, it was normal like to work the whole movie and to any day we could give any line of the movie because we knew them, we worked them. And because of all those discussions with Jacques and Olivier as well, even if sometimes, some days we change things very quickly.
Yes.
But we were ready and we knew the story and from where we are to where we go, so it was...
Ah, comment on dit la rigueur, la tenue, c'est la rigueur, quoi, de l'exigence...
Rigueur.
Ah, rigueur.
Expectations, c'est les attentes, c'est...
Non, je voulais dire que le théâtre apprend la rigueur du travail du texte.
Non.
Rigorous, mais je dirais plutôt hard work.
Yeah,
rigorous.
Rigorous, you know.
Yeah.
Practicing theater learns that.
Teaches it, yeah, that's true.
Teaches that,
yeah.
That's right.
But we were like very demanding to them because as François says, there were some days there were like a lot of text in the same night of shooting. And as we had an experience with theater actors a few years ago that we filmed a text, a theater play on sets with actors from the stage production, but not a stage, it was not a film about a production. It was, we took actors from a play and we filmed them on location. But they knew perfectly the text and it was a very complicated text, but we also have a very short time to shoot the film. And we had disagreement with those actors that if we are happy with one take, we just take one, we just do one. And so I proposed to François and Geoffrey that we didn't do it like that every time because it was probably too much pressure. But if sometimes we are happy with the first take, we can decide all together, but generally it's me who decide. But
just to make sure the power here.
But I wanted to be agreed. We didn't do it too many times, but sometimes, and especially for one very long scene just outside of the club, the first take was like magical. And I knew the night will be very difficult. So I said, it's great. Are you happy? They said, it's okay. And the DOP was like, you're crazy. And I said, you want to see it on the monitor, because generally we don't look at the text on the monitor, but as I don't want to do another one, I agree to look at it.
Okay.
But he was totally frightened because it was his first feature. It was the second night of the shooting outside of the club. But I think when sometimes you have to do that decision, because it crystallized the energy. And there were other days that it was sometimes, and in the same day, for example, a little bit after, we had a problem to choreography the camera with the actors. So we were very happy to have time, to have saved time in the beginning of the night, to have more time to this difficult scene. And so it's always like a negotiation that I have with myself, and after that with all the crew to use the time the best we can. But for that, we need the help of the actors. I mean, we need that the actors are always good, and they can be good and very good and better.
Mm-hmm.
But it's all the fascinating thing of the set for me, that you can be able sometimes to do that, to know that it's great, and I don't want to see another proposition, and sometimes I know that it's good, but maybe we can have it better.
Mm-hmm.
And for us, it was really, it put us in a great place, because first you feel like, before the movie, we were like, it's kind of scary to know that we will only do maybe one or two or three takes, but in another way, it make us feeling confident, and it gives the idea that, okay, you trust us enough to be able to do it like this. So it's scary, but it makes us being more confident, so it's good.
Do you think that French cinema at the moment is telling good stories? Sorry, this is a very broad question, but I was just thinking, because I
see the report.
Like,
it's for
the
you.
We can answer, that they're colleagues.
That's
wonderful movies.
No,
it's
no,
the best.
You can be rude.
No,
no.
Dude, you have to be, I don't think you have to be, I don't think you have to be rude. I think it's beautiful, really.
It's complicated because you know, French cinema is very like it's a lot of different cinemas, and honestly, for me, there in the mainstream French cinema, there's a lot of films that I don't really understand why they exist, but like in American cinema or in any cinema. But probably we have the chance in France that maybe you have to open, because it can be.
Okay, just finish this.
Yeah, yeah.
I have to go.
What I was saying, yes, but in a little bit more artistic approach. What I wanted to say is that we're still lucky in France that we have a lot of directors, we have a lot of young directors. I'm also like in charge of the direction department at the Cinema Movie School, and I know there's a lot of newcomers, you know, a lot of young people who really want to do things, and they don't want to be directors, but they want to tell stories or to have new approach of cinema. They are really trying to figure what they can do, which is very contemporary, which will give an interesting view of our country.
Mm-hmm.
So this aspect of the French cinema for me is really very interesting. The promise of the fact that the cinema can regenerate from generation to generation, but.
Mm-hmm.
In the same time, as everywhere, we also have, you know, this like very classic or conventional directors who made films just because they cast well-known actors, and they do always the same film, and nobody really wants to see those films. I mean, I don't want to see those films. But. So I was a little bit rude.
No, it's okay, but very diplomatic, yeah. Thank you very much for bringing this film to the Berlinale.
Thank you very much.